Yeah, I mean, they're still technically in the division race, the New York Giants. I mean,
True,
technically they
true.
are. So, I mean, as bad as they have been, and they've won one game and it came down to a failed 2-point conversion, or they'd be winless like the Jets, they still are technically right there.
It's interesting. If you look at the schedules for these teams moving forward, the Washington football team could win their next four games. They could actually win their next four games
Let
if
me
you
see
look at
that
their
schedule.
schedule right now. And
Yeah.
you know, I don't know about the Giants. The Giants, you know, are in the midst and the throes of games that they should have already won. That, you know, honestly, I could sit here and tell you they should have beaten the Cowboys and they should have beaten the Eagles. They should have, and they didn't.
All right, so they got a bye this week, the Giants? Or no? I mean, not the Giants, the Washington
Washington is
football
on a
team.
bye, yeah, so Ron Rivera gets to rest a little bit after finishing his chemotherapy yesterday and ringing the
Which was
bell.
great.
It
That
was
was
awesome,
awesome.
yes.
What a great video. I'm glad they put that out
On
there.
top of that, he beat down the Cowboys the day before.
Yeah, I know. That's like as good as it gets
Yes.
for a guy like him who definitely deserves it. Yeah, so they got Giants, Lions, Bengals, and Cowboys in a row. You're right. They could be the team. Could be them. Washington football team, division champs, after all the adversity they've gone through with Dan Snyder and that story in the Washington Post and everything else that was going on. Dwayne Haskins, that could be your division winner. I mean, it can't be the Cowboys at this
Dropping
point.
their nickname.
Yeah, dropping their nickname, that too, of course. It could be them. Wouldn't that be a twist of fate?
It
Yeah,
would
it's
be.
definitely not going to be the Cowboys. It's probably not going to be the Giants. It's going to come down to Washington and the Eagles
Oh,
and.
what really turns your stomach if you're a Giant fan is your team has been competitive. They've unlike the Jets, they have been competitive. And they've been in every single one of these games. And a play here or a play there, they are sitting here with, you know, three wins. I'm telling you, between the Philadelphia game and the Dallas Cowboy game. I mean, they should have won both of those games.
No, I know. They'd be heavy favorites to win the
I mean,
division if that were the case.
that crappy pass interference call when Evan Ingram's going in for a touchdown, and then the screw up on the field goal, fake field goal.
Well, yeah, that too.
And
And
then you
then
had the
not.
Evan Ingram, if you want to call it a drop, that's fine.
No, it was
Call it a drop at the end of the
definitely a
game for
drop.
Philadelphia.
100% a drop.
That would have
And
won the
then,
game there too.
yeah. And well, and they also had opportunities after that, and the defense choked, and they couldn't get the job done.
Right.
So, yeah. I mean, not like this team's going anywhere. I
But
mean,
it's
it's
not like
not
this
as
team
if.
is bad. I mean, like, they've been losing for 3 years. I know that. You know, and I tell my Giant fans, and my Giant fans, fan friends are just completely livid. They've had enough. They're exhausted. You know, we're the Giants. We shouldn't be kicked around like this and made fun of. And, you know, it's bad. I know that. But they're in every game, it feels like, except for that one game.
Yeah. Do you think Dave Gettleman, not that they're going to fire him, but do you think that this is it for him? Like he probably
No.
resigns, retires at the end of this year?
I don't know if you ask me. I mean, Dexter Lawrence looks good. Tomlinson looks good. I would even say Leonard Williams looks good. You know, if you're a football fan and you
Not at
want
the
say,
what he's getting paid.
but if
It's
you
insane.
but that's what defensive linemen who play every game and don't get hurt get paid. You
Ugh.
know, he does things on the football field that I know don't equate to sacks, but you know what? He makes tackles and he is in the middle of a defense and he's asked to do something that, you know, people can't appreciate what he does. He's a good, solid football player, and that's what the going rate is for a good, solid football player.
Well, his two biggest picks, though, one, the jury's still out. The other one, we're not going to see for another year. So, I mean, we can go around the entire roster. Of course, he's got his fingerprints on it, but.
I think the biggest mistake that Dave Gettleman made was the crowning of Saquon Barkley as a gold jacket guy.
Yeah.
Anytime you make that kind of declarative declaration, I should say,
Yeah.
I think, and you're putting an enormous amount of pressure on that player. And quite frankly, there were times where Saquon did look like that, and then there were other times where Saquon looked like anything but that.
Sure. I mean, he's missed significant time. I mean, this year he's basically missing the whole year. Last year he missed significant time. Then when he came back here, he didn't look like himself. So, yeah. I mean, and Daniel Jones is the other one. I mean, Dave Gettleman's tenure and Dave Gettleman's legacy as a Giants general manager will be tied to those two guys more than anybody else.
Well, tied to Daniel, because Daniel either will camouflage the shortcomings
Well,
or he'll get swallowed up by them
right.
and then he'll have to move on somewhere else.
But remember, too, there was that quarterback draft of that year, and I know not everybody has worked out, but that draft was chock full of guys that could have been the Giants quarterback. And they waited a year. And they took Saquon, then they took Daniel Jones. So it really comes down to Daniel, you're right. But to Saquon, one, I mean, when you second overall pick, that's something you can't screw up.
Well, especially when you call him a gold jacket guy.
Yeah, gold jacket guy. Gold jacket guy. Yeah, right now he is he's a no-mask guy hanging out with guys named DJ Lughead doing he's a no-ACL guy.
No-mask, no-ACL guy, right.
Yeah, right.
Andrew Thomas was a can't-miss left tackle selection by the Giants. Everybody said that this kid is just an absolutely great kid. He's going to be a great athlete. He had great technique at Georgia.
There was one guy who didn't, and he said it at the time. You know who that was Joe Thomas, former All-Pro offensive lineman, who at the time said that everybody was overrating Andrew Thomas just because of the games that he played, the competition that he faced, and he saw major flaws in his technique. And you know who the guy that he rated the best offensive lineman coming out of the draft was?
Mekhi Becton.
Yes, that's right.
I know. So anyway, all right, so that's Joe Thomas. There's always going to be dissenters. You know that. I mean, and that's fine. And I would take Joe Thomas for his word, much like I would take Paul Alexander at his word. I think both of them, you know, bring a wealth of knowledge about the position and how to play the position and techniques and everything. So in yesterday's article, Paul Alexander was saying how, you know, this doesn't look like the same player at Georgia, that he wasn't using the same techniques. He just looked different. And I was just thinking, is that a swipe at the offensive line coach of the Giants?
Yeah, probably.
Right?
Yeah.
Is this what we're doing now? We're sniping, you know, coaches and stuff like that?
Well, backhandedly, yes.
But here's what I would say. When they drafted him, they thought Nate Solder was going to be the left tackle. They would start him at right tackle, where it's not quite as difficult. It's still difficult no matter what you say, and still adjusting to the NFL game, the speed of the NFL pass rushers. And every week you're playing another good team that's got another scheme, and you got to learn all these things. And quite frankly, when you're at Georgia, you're mauling people. You're just basically mauling people, except maybe for Alabama and maybe LSU when they're good. But everybody else on your schedule, you're just drilling. So my thing is like I want all these young kids to turn out to be something, and I don't want them to get chopped up before, you know, they get into their second and third year. And hopefully we'll give Andrew Thomas time to settle in. But he's been thrown into the fire probably well before they wanted to put him in this situation. And, you know, I just reading that article yesterday just made me feel bad for the kid. And because I know Giant fans are all over him. They're all over Gettleman. They're all over, you know, because they're losing. And, you know, he's given up more pressures and sacks than all the other rookie tackles that were taken in the first round combined.
Yeah, this is from the Post. This is Joe Thomas, who was talking about the offensive lineman. Andrew Thomas was the most risky. With an offensive lineman's eye, you look at him right away and say he has a lot of room to grow and he needs a ton of work and reps. Others were basing it on accolades, not game film, playing in the SEC and tons of starts. He checked a lot of the boxes that typically have not failed for offensive tackles, but then you watch the tape and clearly see biomechanically it doesn't match up with those other guys. So he's going biomechanics on you with Andrew Thomas.
Yeah, so whatever the issues are, they're there, and they are definitely impacting Daniel Jones. They're definitely impacting the play caller, in this case, Jason Garrett. You know, there should be areas in which you can help a tackle if he has a problem. Like last week, they gave up a sack, or I think it was a sack against the Eagles, and it was just a kind of a blitz where the defensive end – you know, went way inside, and Andrew went in with him, and, you know, he and Hernandez were together, and then all of a sudden, either the linebacker or the safety came around Andrew Thomas, and he didn't react fast enough. You know, I don't know if he's ever seen that before at that speed, and that's obviously something that Jim Schwartz, the defensive coordinator of the Philadelphia Eagles, saw that maybe they could take advantage of his inexperience over there in a situation like that. And, you know, like I've always said, on the offense, you know, if you make a mistake, somebody's paying the price for that mistake. And it could be a physical mistake and it could be a mental mistake. The physical mistakes you can live with, it's when you're not knowing what you're doing out there. And then when you're not knowing what you're doing out there, you can't just play. You can't just let it go and you can't let your natural physical ability, you know, come out there and show just how good you can be. You know, and sometimes it just takes a while for kids to figure out the game, to get comfortable and to realize that they belong. And I'm already sure for a guy like Andrew Thomas, who's under just an immense amount of scrutiny, it's been a long year already for him.
You think the Giants? Exhausted. Yeah, I think the Giants should make a couple trades at this trade deadline to get rid of some guys that aren't going to be here next year, like Golden Tate.
Yeah, I you know, if you got a reasonable draft pick for him, and you could move him, and you
What's a reasonable? I mean, any draft pick, well, I think, for a guy in an expiring contract.
Well, you know, I don't know, a 6th round pick, or you know, or maybe a flip of picks, or maybe something to be named later. Yeah, yeah. I get it. But you also have to make sure you have people that can play those positions on the team that are healthy and ready to go, and you have a young guy that you want to play and you want to see more of. Yeah, I'm all for that, but you're not just giving guys away. You need guys that you can still play with on Sunday.
Well, yeah, but we talked about how those draft pick assets are so important more than ever. I mean, there's a couple of guys. I know Kevin Zeitler is another name that's been tossed around there. Zeitler and Tate.
I think teams would love to have Kevin Zeitler. I really do. The question is, what are you getting back in return for them? And also remember, there's the compensatory picks that come along with losing free agents in the offseason too. So
sure.
You have to kind of measure that against what you are being offered now, if in fact you are trying to trade these players. I mean, this is not Major League Baseball. This is not hockey. The trade deadline, you know, isn't going to like create a flurry of, you know, 15 trades. It's just not going to happen.
Yeah, no, I know. I've seen it many times at this point.
Look
but
at that.
Yeah, it's incredible. But, you know, Daniel Jones wasn't that much slower than DK Metcalf. He was like just like 1 mile an hour slower than DK Metcalf was when he opened it up.
Well, the big difference is that Daniel Jones actually had the football, as did Budda Baker. So that doesn't allow them to use their offhand as, you know, as a vehicle to help you move faster the way that DK Metcalf was moving.
Right.
Look at that. I mean, it's unbelievable when I see that.
No, I know. I know. He is a stud for sure. And he's actually been a real football player, not just like, you know, some sort of guy made in a lab who couldn't play football. I mean, it is insane. You know, the Daniel Jones thing is just, you know, his body, his legs were moving faster than his body was. Is what it came down to. He just couldn't keep up. And that was the end of it.
That poor kid, too bad.
I know.
But you know what? It just goes to show you how good of an athlete he is, though.
Oh, sure. No, without a doubt. I mean, listen, he's running every game. He's running, except for the Cowboy game, when I bet his over rushing yards. He didn't even leave the pocket. But every game, he's making big plays with his legs. And he's not really, you know, in the beginning, when we saw him last year, it felt like he was putting himself in dangerous situations. He's not doing that anymore. Not at all. He seems to be able to protect himself, and he's got, you know, there's a run or two every game where it's like massive.
That would have been so good for him to score that touchdown. That would have been amazing. Yeah. But again, like, you see things like that. You see the throw to Sterling Shepard. You see the throw to Golden Tate. You see that run. You see other runs in the game where, like I said, where he gets in trouble is when he has a little bit too much time, and, you know, he's got to think about it, and then all of a sudden makes the wrong decision or just does a, you know, just makes another, like, forced mistake where he's got to kind of roll that back a little bit, and he'll get better. He'll get better. I'm telling you, he will get better. It may not be this week against Tampa, but he'll get better.
What do you think the spread is on that game?
10?
It is 10.5.
10. 10.5. Okay.
10.5. Giants plus 10.5 against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
I do, you know, first of all, I wouldn't bet the game. But I'm sure we'll end up picking it, right? So,
oh, of course. So we're going to have to pick those two massive spread games. Yeah,
yes.
The Jets and the Chiefs.
Well,
and
we had the Giants. I had the Giants Thursday night. Did you take the Giants Thursday night?
I did. I did pick them. I picked them every single week.
Okay.
Except 1 week I didn't pick them.
Mm-hmm.
And they screwed me, actually. I didn't pick them against the Cowboys. I thought the Cowboys were going to beat them.
They're hanging tough, but I think Tampa
badly.
And Tom Brady is, you know, Monday Night Football. He's going to be trying to make a statement, you know. He's always trying to make a statement now. I think now he's really trying to show everybody that he's going to throw the ball down the field. He's going to throw it outside the hash marks. All the things that were he was, I think, being criticized for when he was playing in New England, he's trying to do all the things that supposedly he wasn't doing there.
Wouldn't it be great if the Giants stole this one, though, somehow? I mean, that'd get your fan base fired up. Then you think they could do something.
Well, they do. They have beaten Tom Brady a couple times, haven't they?
Yes, they have. There's a different quarterback, different head coach, but yes, they certainly have.
Thank you for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe. And don't forget to hit the red bell so you're notified when we have new content.